Hello everybody, my name is Martijn Bogaert. I am from a company called Rischker. We are an embedded security evaluation lab. If you want to know more about us, we actually have a booth next to the entrance. But what I'm here for now is to talk about OptiE and fuzzing OptiE using AFL. I am a senior security analyst, and I have been working for the last couple of years on working on the evaluation of the security of TE solutions. This includes all kinds of proprietary solutions, including solutions based on OptiE. And actually, one of my interests in the last couple of years, already from before I joined Rischker, is researching fuzzing techniques and simulation techniques. And this has resulted in a number of projects, some of which I also have presented before. And what I would like to talk about is, well, I think in this audience I don't have to introduce what a TE is, right? Because I see several core developers of the project. But maybe if there's for anybody, I will very quickly go over it. Discuss why fuzzing TE is difficult, and well, is it actually difficult? And then show the work I did on fuzzing the system call interface of OptiE. And you might ask, well, why are you doing this type of stuff? Why did you do this? And one of the main motivations for that is we do a lot of TE work. We see TEs more and more. It's actually a mandatory component, right, in Android. I think since version 6, if you have, for example, a fingerprint sensor. But also we start to see it more in more markets. And of course, it is. Because it is a very high privilege component, this of course has also, well, high requirements regarding the security robustness. And of course the whole idea is that inside our chip we have the normal Android environment, and next to that we have a secure environment and some assets which are unique to that environment, probably some cryptographic keys. And pretty much every major vendor nowadays has some form of a TE solution. Well, they have some differences on a high level, they are all the same, and I'm just going to talk about OptiE. So we have our normal world, where we run Android or some Linux environment. We have a secure world, where we have OptiE, a bunch of trusted applications and some mechanism to switch in between. We have client applications calling trusted applications and some shared resources, such as shared memory, that is shared between both worlds. And something to keep in mind here is that a trusted application that runs in the TE is nothing like a normal application you run in the normal world. Actually, what we see the most is that trusted applications are actually only written by the chip vendor or the OEM, or in the case of the OptiE project, by the OptiE maintainers. And well, what's here in common is that we have the global platform API that standardizes how TAs use the underlying TE solution. And to have a quick look how this looks like, I have a small example just to do an AES operation using the global platform API, which consists of several steps like initializing the crypto system, allocating the corresponding objects, allocating the states, populating the object with a key, and then eventually doing the actual operation using the key. However, this is just the surface, and actually when we go deeper, what we will see is that this high-level API is actually for a major part implemented through system calls in the operating system. And actually the very same example, we can actually drill down to a series of system calls that are made back into the operating system, again to allocate objects, again to allocate the corresponding state objects, populate the state objects, doing the initialization of this crypto subsystem, and eventually executing the operation. And that brings us to OptiE system calls. We have a bunch of system calls in there. some random system calls like logging, panicking, cross TA calls. And there are two major components, the secure storage and the cryptographic system calls. In total, there are like, I think roughly 55 system calls. Not that long ago, I think roughly 15 of them have been removed. Before, we also had the secure element subsystem, which is now removed. However, one question we ask as a security lab is trusted also equal to secure? Especially because there are many vendors that take a solution such as OptiE and then start adding their own extensions to it. And of course, we do a lot of manual evaluations involving code review of the modifications and also of the core system itself. However, this, well, it takes an awful lot of time and, well, who doesn't like automation, right? And one of the techniques that has been invented for finding issues or finding bugs in an automated way is fuzzing. And there are several techniques you can use for fuzzing a system. And actually, for trusted execution environments, this goes already back to 2014, when there was a colleague that made a very crude fuzzer for a proprietary TE solution, which I am exaggerating, but it is basically coming down to piping random data in the TE interface. And back then, this was enough to basically crash the solution they were looking at. And this was also hitting a major problem here. Like, okay, we are crashing it, but why? It was a complete black box, and this was actually when they decided, well, we need a different approach, and, well, this became a lot of code review. Well, of course, sending random data nowadays will not give you that much results anymore. There are other techniques. For example, you could have a model of the interface and generate corrupted inputs based on that. But actually, for fuzzing in the more fuzzing in the normal world, there is actually a technique that is very interesting, which is using coverage information from the target to have an evolutionary algorithm generating new inputs based on the inputs that are taken through the binary. And this relies on a quite simple algorithm. We start with a collection of inputs that try to trigger as unique code paths as possible. And what we then do is we start mutating these inputs one at a time, for example by flipping a bit. And then you run the target with this as input and you see what the effect is of this mutation on the data. This works by collecting trace information or code coverage information from the binary and see, well, this result in for example, new code that is executed, or did the code behave differently? For example, instead of going once through a loop, you go twice through a loop. So this is something that actually became popular, well, maybe 10 years ago. However, one of the main questions here is, of course, how do we know what the branch is that has been taken? And one of the approaches that had been developed for this, and actually there are quite some tools that are using that, is by adding extra code, injecting function calls in every basic block that basically keep track of which basic block you have executed inside your binary. And if you then implement this function as a way that extracts where it is from where in the code it is being called from, you can actually keep track on how an input triggers new behavior in a binary. This is just all out there, this is existing work. But why can't we just use these existing systems on, for example, operating systems? So why is fuzzing operating systems more difficult than, for example, an image parser? Well, if you are, for example, running the fuzzer as an application under your operating system, a crash of the operating system also brings down your fuzzer. You have problems with a global state in your system. For example, every file you open or every object you allocate is changing the global state, while especially when you are dealing with a code coverage-based system, you want to have each fuzzing attempt starting from the same global state. But also, suddenly, you cannot simply inject function calls anymore to collect the trace information. You actually need to have a smarter system to somehow expose this trace information to the fuzzer or maybe outside of the system. And next to that, for fuzzing an image parser, you can just collect a collection of images and use that to seed the fuzzer. For an operating system, you sort of need to have inputs that basically trigger code paths in the OS, probably system calls, and this is not really something that is widely available. You could maybe use something from existing fuzzing projects, but also there the amount of things you can use are quite limited. And what I said before is that global state is a problem. Well, actually, there are more sources of this problem. There are actually all kinds of things going on in the operating system that make it very hard to get a deterministic behavior of the code and basically have stable code traces triggered by the input. And sources of this can be multiprocessing that's going on, threading, interrupts coming from the hardware, etc. But actually, there has been a lot of good work from Google and others, resulting in projects like AFL and Syscaller that have actually solved a lot of these problems on a level that, well, there are very good fuzzers out there. So can we somehow use that maybe for fuzzing a trusted execution environment? And this actually brings me to my goal of this project. I would like to write a fuzzer for OPTE, and I would like to do that without, doing it from scratch. So let's try to make use of the existing work. And I'm also looking for good results and not perfect results. My time for these projects is limited. So let's see how far we can get. But why is fuzzing TEs then difficult? Well, we have all the challenges of an operating system, but actually, because it is isolated, because it's a separated operating system next to the normal world, it actually gets even more challenging. And also the fact that we have a very limited API that is being exposed makes it more difficult. And while I could, for example, to first the Linux system call interface, take a starting set of inputs from previous fuzzing projects, as far as I know, such thing is not available for any TE solution. So what I did is I tried to use AFL for fuzzing OPTE. So let's quickly take a look at how AFL works. So AFL actually expects to be able or to fuzz an application, it could be Linux, Windows, whatever operating application, and it works by starting this application many times. And each time it starts the application, it will actually provide an input, and the application then sends back the code trace data in the form of a bitmap to AFL. And this bitmap is, it basically looks like a bunch of bytes that sort of indicates if you have triggered a certain location in the code and how often you have triggered this. There is not really a one-to-one relation between a location in the bitmap and an actual location in the code, but it sort of works that if you see something changing from a 0 to a 1, you have triggered some code you have never executed before, and if the number gets higher, it's something you have seen before, but you have triggered it multiple times. So let's then use AFL for fuzzing OPTE. Well, we have seen that the system calls are quite limited, and AFL uses all kinds of system calls, but you are not going to find them inside the TE, right? You are not going to be able to fork or execve a new application. So running AFL inside the TE is simply not feasible, at least not without a complete rewrite. And it might be doable, but it's not, it's not really worth it in my opinion. So can we do something else? Can we maybe still run AFL in the normal world while we are still fuzzing the system call interface of OPTE? So what I did is I run AFL, and it actually, instead of fuzzing directly an application, I have created a set of proxy applications that actually forward the fuzzing that is going on. So in this case, I have a client application proxy, which using the normal libraries communicates with the TE and actually forwards the input that is generated by AFL to a proxy trusted application, and this proxy trusted application is basically able to generate arbitrary sequences of system calls. So AFL provides some blob of data to the client application forwards it to the trusted application, and the trusted application then makes random system calls. And then inside the TE, we collect which code paths are being triggered due to this, and actually this information is fed back into AFL. And due to this setup, AFL actually thinks it is fuzzing the client application, and the client application behaves as if it is fuzzed directly by AFL, while in reality, what is being fuzzed is completely in a different part of the system. But how can we actually make random system calls using AFL? Because AFL is a general purpose fuzzer, and it has actually absolutely no notion of the data at all. So how can we make AFL generate system calls? And this actually brings me to some data format I have developed for this purpose, and this data format allows you to basically specify sequences of system calls and their arguments. And this is, for example, an example that generates the invocation of the lock system call just to print a message. And in this case, this system call takes two arguments, a pointer to a buffer, and the length that needs to be printed. And inside this binary data is encoded how this system call should be invoked and with which data. And this is actually the hardest part for fuzzing a system like this. How can we actually encode all the system calls through a data format like this? And system calls in OpTE are basically some number that represent which system call is being invoked with up to 8 arguments. And this could be a simple integer value, but it can also be a pointer to some data, some structures, but also a pointer to a structure which has a pointer to some data. And this actually makes it quite tricky to encode all these this information in one data format. And also, system calls can have dependencies. If you think back of our example of the cryptographic operation, actually all those system calls depend on each other and actually uses handles allocated by the previous system call. So we need to encode the information as well. And the way it works is basically a binary format that specifies this, which basically starts with encoding information about the system calls, followed by arbitrary data, which can then be referenced from the system calls. And the whole idea behind this, by the way the data format is designed, is that a single bit flip, because this is one of the mutations by AFL, should have as much should be as likely as possible to trigger completely new behavior. So by flipping a bit, it should turn in a different invocation without invalidating the data format. And so how does this work? Well, let's go back to the example of invoking the logging system call. We start with specifying which system call we want to invoke, and then we have actually a 32-bit value that specifies what type of arguments will follow for this system call. And actually, each nibble here specifies the type of argument that will follow. In this case, we have two arguments that will follow, and they are of a different type. So what we have as first argument is actually a specification of a buffer. And then as a second argument, we have just a normal integer value, which is the length of the data that needs to be printed. And the way it works is that in the next 32-bit values, this then encodes as this is a buffer with data coming from the file, or this is an integer value. And the way it works is that inside this value is encoded where it should find the buffer data and how much of this data that comes from the data format is actually to be copied in this buffer. And this allows you to actually specify completely arbitrary sequences of system calls. This is, for example, the definition of, doing an AES encryption operation using a single, basically just a string of data that needs to be encrypted. So how does it work? Let's go in a little bit more detail. So in the fuzzer, there is actually a definition of all the system calls, the UTE wrapper functions, and the amount of arguments that correspond with the system calls. And this is basically enough based on the data format to actually make the system calls. However, we still have the problem that it's not trivial for a fuzzer to figure out that this is the correct way of using the system calls. So if you just launch the fuzzer with an empty file, it will actually find, given enough time, valid system calls it can execute, but it will take an awful long time to figure out that this is the way to do an AES encryption. And this would be just a waste of resources. Of course, I could create all of them by hand. And, well, this is a very tedious job. I think this one I created by hand, and that's like an hour of work. And you don't want to do this for everything that is supported by the system call interface. So how can we actually do this maybe in some form of an automated way? Well, ideally, you have a starting set that covers as much functionality as possible. And what do we have that covers as much functionality as possible of OPTE? Well, a test suite. A test suite that actually has a lot of tests that actually are valid invocations of this system call interface. I think it literally contains thousands of tests for pretty much all system call interfaces. So can we maybe somehow use this? Can we maybe turn each test case in a valid input for the fuzzer? So we have the XTest application, which is the one that actually executes all the test cases. And we have a bunch of test applications that, based on the test definition of XTest, will do a series of system call invocations. So can we somehow capture each of those test cases and turn them in an input for the fuzzer? Well, if we can somehow log all the system calls that are being done by those test cases, maybe we can actually do something with that. And what I've done, I've added a logging framework in OPTE that basically captures all the raw data of the system calls. And this data is then actually exported back to the normal world, where this data is written to a file, which is then the test case for the fuzzer. However, this, of course, if you just replay the raw values, this is not going to bring you very far. Maybe in Qemu, this can work, because if you just start a new instance and not really having a lot of randomness, you have maybe a high chance of getting the same random value for your handles, etc. Still, it's not going to bring you very far. So actually what I do is not just logging the raw data, but also turn this in not so much the literal values, but more a description of the intended behavior. And the idea is that we do not encode like an address, but we encode the intention to provide a pointer to a buffer that contains some data. So how does this work? Well, actually inside the fuzzer, or actually in the logging framework, there's actually more information. It actually contains information about what the types are for the data that is expected by every system call. For example, in the case of a logging system call, it expects a buffer as input, and inside the second argument of the system call, it will find the length of the buffer that is provided by that pointer. And actually, this way, I can encode all the different types of data that is expected by system calls. For example, it expects arrays of data of a certain type. It actually copies data out, or to this pointer it will write a handle. So if we then have the raw invocation information for the system calls in combination with this, how the system call is supposed to be used, we can actually make a description of the behavior. For example, in the case of the state allocation, it needs to get a valid handle to the crypto object it just allocated in the previous system call. However, the previous system call only gets a pointer to where the system call will write the handle, and not so it needs to extract that, it needs to look at that address for that handle and dereference that pointer basically for the next system call. And that is then turned in that test case we have seen before. And this test case actually has this information embedded. For example, the handle that is expected by our crypto state allocation is defined as a dereference of a buffer that was provided to the crypto objects allocation. And I can actually demonstrate this. So what I have here is I have OptiE running in QEMU. On the right side I have the TE serial output, and on the left side I have just my normal world Linux shell with a minimal system. And what I now can do is I have modified the Hello World application a little bit, and what it does is it basically it invokes the Hello World TA, it will provide a key, a plain text, and ask the TE to encrypt that data for you. And what I then can do is I can specify a special environment variable which triggers some behavior in the client library that basically says to the TE, like, hey, from this moment on you need to start to pay attention to all the system calls that are being made in this session, because this is interesting information and I want you to provide, when the session is closed, all this information back to me. And what I now can do is I can actually rerun my test case. And it actually, in the normal world, it has now printed that it has written some trace to a temporary file. But actually on the right side, you will see that the TE spitted out an awful lot more information. And this is actually the recognition of all the system calls that are being made by the TA. For example, it has recognized that there is a crypto object population system call being made. It has recognized that it is a pointer. This points to a buffer of a certain size, but also that, well, what the data that is inside the buffer, etc. So, and this is then actually written in the file format I discussed earlier and copied back to the normal world, where I now have a file that is literally a capture of the behavior of the system calls made by the Hello World TA. And I can now actually replay this file. And you will actually see that the TE has actually redone those system calls exactly the same, with the same data, but now based on the file definition. And, well, I can do this with Hello World, or with the Hello World application. But I also can do it with XTest. And this will take a while, I think in the order of 2 hours or something, because it's an awful lot of work to capture all that information and writing it back to the normal world. But if you run this, at the end you have a few thousand test cases you can put in the fuzzer. Not sure if it's actually smart to leave it running on the background. So, all this combined results in a working fuzzer, and I actually found some issues with it, reported some issues. However, it has some problems. For example, the trace instability, the non-determinism of the code, is really a major problem, especially on real hardware, but even in QEMU it is a pain. And there are several reasons for it, interrupts being one of them. Also, the global state inside the kernel or in the OptiE kernel is a major challenge, and resetting this without having to restart the entire system. Because, well, I could easily solve it by completely rebooting the TE for each fuzzing attempt. However, well, how long does it take to boot? 30 seconds, 20 seconds? So this completely kills the fuzzer performance. And also to keep track of what's being done by the fuzzer. While it is possible to do that, and I've actually made a tool that allows me to visualize exactly which parts of the TE binary are triggered by the fuzzer, it's not ideal to do this from the binary. But maybe an even bigger problem is performance. In QEMU, I may be able to get 30 executions a second. On hardware, well, it's a bit more. I did some in a very long time ago. I did some tests on the high keyboard where, well, a few hundred executions a second. But what do you want for a fuzzer? 1,000 executions a second, 10,000, or far more than that. Definitely more than 30 to a few hundred. So I started to think a while ago, can I maybe do something completely radically different? Yes, it works, but I would like to go much deeper in the system. And actually, something I've done a couple of years ago, somewhere around 2017, is that for training purposes, I have made an OptiE emulator that runs directly under Linux, just as a normal Linux application. And the way it works is that I have a client application process that communicates with some kernel process, which then starts one or more trusted application processes and uses some extremely dirty tricks for system call emulation and TA emulation. And actually, the most interesting part here is it sort of works. It is a heck of a job to get every system call working, but I sort of got the crypto core working, and I was sort of proud of that. Can I somehow leverage this idea? Can I maybe do something with that? And the idea I got is it maybe possible to not only use the test suite for seeding the fuzzer, but can I actually reuse the very same code, execute it in a fast way to generate more test cases based on different behavior of the code? And this has actually resulted in that I started to build an OptiE simulator, and this simulator actually runs as a Linux binary. And the idea is that AFL versus this simulator as hard as possible, as fast as possible, and each unique test case that is generated this way is then replayed under the real fuzzer to see if it, well, maybe actually triggers some interesting behavior in the system. And the way it works is I basically ported OptiE to become an user mode Linux process. And use that to see the real fuzzer. On standard in, it actually accepts a sequence of system calls that I want to execute in the very same data format that we have discussed before. It will execute it, and then we actually feedback as if it is any normal Linux application feedback the behavior back into AAVL and use it to find unique sequences of system calls. And the idea was, well, most likely I'm going to trigger a lot of crashes, not so much because I'm triggering real bugs, but not so much because I'm triggering bugs in the code, but because, my simulator is really not going to be perfect, right? So how does it work? Well, we have AFL and we have a simulator, and basically the simulator reuses, well, maybe 80% of the OptiE code. And next to that, I have added some components. I have added a parser for the data format. I have implemented a new system called dispatcher to actually invoke all the code, adding some AFL instrumentation, and all the interfaces to the hardware, like loading page tables, all that kind of stuff, I have stripped away. The bitmap goes back to AFL, and AFL, at least the inputs that trigger unique behavior, then go to the real fuzzer. Interestingly enough, it was really not that hard to do this. I had to strip away roughly 100 functions and globals, and this was enough to run quite a big part of the OptiE code this way. I don't have time to go over all the details of the things I did to make it work better. But what I did is, a couple of hours ago, I actually... I started the fuzzer with a whole bunch of existing test cases. And in the meantime, we are 3 hours later, it has already generated over 6 million attempts. And the performance is a bit flaky. At the moment, it is not that fast, but that has more to do with the fact that I think it tries to do sequences of like 50 system calls at the moment. I have seen it go well over 5,000-6,000 attempts per second when the test cases were smaller initially. By now it has already figured out almost 5,000 unique ways of invoking the system call interface. This is just on one core of this laptop. And actually the nice thing about this approach is it scales very well. This is just a normal Linux process. Per further instance, it takes one CPU core, take an quad-core, octo-core machine, and you have 4, 8, 16 further instances, and it really scales. Well, for example, if you use QEMU or real hardware, you cannot really scale that well. And that brings me to something else. Because I'm now fuzzing a normal Linux application, I can suddenly also leverage all the work the community has already done for improving fuzzing. And one of the things is I can just use the standard compiler support to generate generate basically a web page that on a line level will show me you have executed this line and how many lines you have executed or how many times it was executed in the fuzzer this way. And this actually gives very nice statistics, like of this file you have now covered 60% of the code. And I actually can go in that file and actually see, okay, so this part of the function I was not able to fuzz yet. Why would that be? Is it maybe expecting some magical value the fuzzer is not able to find? Or is it maybe depending on some data definition that is really difficult for the fuzzer to generate? Or is there maybe a bug in my fuzzer that it is simply impossible to define this specific data structure? And I think I let it run for a while on one of my machines, and I think it got me like 10 times more unique code paths than I had with the original fuzzer. And also, interestingly enough, it's a lot faster. And maybe one of the most interesting things is that it finds real bugs. I was really not expecting it that I would be able to find real bugs with it, but there are things that show up in the simulator, and then I just attach GDB to it, do a backtrace, and I see, for example, oh wait, that's the issue. Well, debugging the real OptiE kernel is quite a bit trickier. A lot of the core code was already open sourced a half a year ago as part of that I gave an earlier version of this presentation on a security conference, NullCon. This is also where it sort of got stuck. For me, this is a side project. I really like to do this type of this type of development, making tools like this, being able to report issues like this and see them fixed. We had already some discussions maybe about seeing what we can do for upstreaming it. However, as you maybe can imagine, this code is extremely invasive in the OptiE code, and I really do not see it happening that easily to have any of it accepted, also because, I am at least not anymore really a developer. The code is beyond ugly. And with that, I would like to basically conclude my presentation, and maybe you have some questions.
Thanks, Martin. That's really good. Thanks. So, just on a fundamental level, you're fuzzing the interface that OptiE presents to its TAs. I'm just thinking, though, from a security point of view, isn't the more important interface is the actual SMC interface that OptiE presents to the normal world, or the SVC interface on the normal world side?
I can imagine, but there are basically two reasons for this. First, the interface that is exposed to the normal world is very contained, small, and very reviewable. The second reason, and the system call interface is much bigger. The second reason is the evaluation conditions we operate under is that actually there also needs to be strong isolation between the TAs. Very often, we do a lot of evaluations, for example, for DRM in the context of DRM, etc. And They would like to prevent even a situation that one of the TAs is breached, their TA can be affected by that. So we actually spent a lot of effort also in evaluating the strength of the TA separation. So from that, basically request from the market for this type of evaluation, that also comes why this was for me the most interesting interface to create a fuzzer for.
So technically it would have been possible, it's just you'd probably less likely to find problems in those interfaces because they're smaller.
They are much smaller and they have been reviewing very extensively. Would it be possible to find issues with fuzzing? Maybe. You find sometimes issues with fuzzing. Code that also I have sometimes checked a dozen of times, and you simply do not see it because it's so tricky that these sequences of events need to happen to trigger the bug, or it is so subtle.
Just one more question, sorry. Does AFL have to run within a Linux environment, or could it run within a kind of a bare metal testing environment?
It will be an extreme or a massive undertaking to lift the dependencies. This is why I made it using a proxy.
Right.
So one reason why it's so much faster as a Linux process is that you run it as x86 code instead, so it's native. Right?
It's native code, plus I can skip all of the overhead of the context switching from secure to normal. All the monitor stuff, the driver stuff in the normal world side, the entry point in the OPTE kernel, all those, and also the TA execution, all that stuff is basically removed, and it is just hammering on the code that is exposed by the system call interface.
So what you have done is really good. The negative side is that you keep me busy a lot. So that's
sorry.
But I just wanted to say that tomorrow we have a hacking session about this also. So we wanted to discuss the things that Matan already mentioned. I mean, can we do something about this being so invasive? I mean, can we simplify the life for whoever would like to use this tool to actually run it on the recent code base in Opti and so on? So if you have interest, please show up tomorrow on that session also.
Yeah.
The time is 12 o'clock.
Any more questions?
Not so much a question, but I'm thinking, you know, the reason I asked my previous question was because I'd like to maybe do something similar on the SMC interfaces in the monitor code itself.
I think that's definitely possible, yeah.
Yeah. We would just, problem is our testing environment is a bare metal, normal world testing environment. We'd have to port some of that stuff to a Linux environment, I guess. Probably easier than the other way around, but
yes.
What you're saying.
It's probably easier to write a complete fuzzer from scratch than to try to port AFL to a bare metal environment. Okay, well, thank you.